Hi there. In this tutorial, I thought I'd go over some of the basics that are worth considering if you want to make something like a photorealistic image. Some of the skills you learn in photorealistic images are obviously very useful when you're creating non-photorealistic images, and certainly photorealism is not a prerequisite of a good image, but it does teach you a lot of different skills and you can use them or not use them as you see fit when you construct your scene. So I've got a few images that I created some time ago so that none of them are perfect and none of them are completely photorealistic. But they demonstrate some of the things that I'm going to cover. So on here we've got a couple of things. We've got obviously the reflectiveness of the wood. So the fact that it has some reflectiveness gives it that sort of darker look to it, which makes it look almost as if there's a varnish on there. But in this case it's a slightly rough varnish because you can see the light disperses quite a bit. You can see on here this wood is somewhat more polished. In other words, the roughness of the glossy is quite a bit less than on here. And then we've got the metal rings, and they're actually, the skill with those is to use a relatively high gloss finish, but with a slight colour to it. And depending on what material you're trying to simulate, affects which colour you use. And you just see a little bit of gold in there, and then there's some kind of crystal or ruby there. Another image here, really quite an old image. We're using the light here to highlight an otherwise transparent liquid. But the key point here is to do with caustics. Without caustics, this fluid, if it was transparent at all, would look very dull indeed. We wouldn't get all these little bright spots. And also, you can see down here there's a little reflection, which has a shape, in this case a square shape. So it sort of simulates a lamp. In this image, again, not 100% photorealistic, but you can see there's some subtle depth of field, as well as several particle systems simulating crumbs. And you can see there's particle system simulating sugar on the surface of these mince pies, and little particles down here as well. In this scene, the reason I highlight this one is there's some subtle translucent light visible in these, and that helps to add to the realism. It gives you that feeling that these petals are real thin petals, and that's also a feature of the grass material as well, although not so obvious. This is ZX81. This is one of the earliest computers that were available in the UK. And again, not 100% photorealistic because I haven't added any dirt or anything like that. If I went to that trouble, this would probably look quite a bit more photorealistic. But again, you've got a surface texture on the wood here that's showing through as though it's a very thin coat of varnish, perhaps a fairly cheap bench, and then obviously different kinds of shiny. And on here, we can see that there's a surface texture on the little computer as well. And I modelled that very carefully with a procedural texture on images of the original device. Here, again, not 100% photorealistic, but it gives a really good impression of the subject because of this depth of field. Atypically, I've got leaves at the front of the scene, close to the camera, that are out of focus, and then things come into focus as they go away, which helps to lead the eye into the picture. I've also used some procedural texturing, and I believe I used some dirty vertex colours in order to help give the variation in colour on the pumpkins. And in this one, it was just modelling something to demonstrate something for someone. But you can see there's quite a complex shader used on these pearls. And that's actually an anisotropic shader. And you can get into quite complex shaders for things like gold rings as well. So just to demonstrate some of these things, one of the main things you need to think about with photorealism is light. So we'll just add a plane just to give us some bounce light. And we'll give it a simple white material. And we'll add a UV sphere halfway through, like that is fine, and set it to smooth shading, and a cube. We'll put that there. I'm actually going to smooth that UV sphere a little bit more with Control 2, and that's added a lot more vertices. I've got some default lights I'm going to bring up, and I'll talk a bit more about lights. So here I've got three simple lights. Each of these things are actually just a plane, and I've labelled them as key light, rim light, and fill light. This is a very common setup. You can see there's my camera. These two are roughly at 45 degrees either side of the camera. And then the rim light sort of off to one side and typically above these objects. Key light is your main source of light. Your fill light, obviously not so bright and just fills in the shadows. And then the rim light is designed to just give you a little bit of bounce light across the rim, particularly useful in highlighting the shape of an object against a dark background. So I'm going to select my first object and add basic material. We'll call that T1. And then I'm going to select my second object and I'm also going to call up T1. So they've both got the same material. And now we'll go to the rendered mode. So we're using these objects, that you saw as lights. You notice straight away that if I select my rim light, which is over here somewhere, it's actually disappeared. And the reason for that, if I go to objects, you can see camera is switched off. So I switch it back on, there it is. If I turn off my fill light, at the moment it's not making a huge amount of difference, so it's probably not big enough. If I press S and scale it up, you can see that's added some into there, and if I now turn it off, you can see the shadows become darker. If I select my key light and turn that off, now you can really see what the fill light is doing. It probably needs to come round a little bit, but you can see it's basically shining on this side. You don't necessarily need this setup of lights. This is just a very standard, simple setup, and I keep it in my default settings. And if we turn that one off as well, we can see what we're getting from the rim light, which isn't a huge amount at the moment. So if we turn the brightness of that one up without turning the size up. And that's another thing I need to mention, that the size of these lights is appropriate to what they're doing. Very often the fill light is actually the largest light. I didn't have it that way in my default setup. If I pull this one back, you have a very small light for this rim light because you want very sharp reflections. A medium size for the key light, and then a large size but not too bright for the fill light. So if we go back to the rendered view and we turn off key and fill, now you can just about see what we might need to do is change the position of that light a little bit there. That's better. So you can just see it's illuminating that edge there, and we can turn that up even higher just to help outline that. So if I turn my other two lights back on, depending on how bright they are, we'll determine whether we can see that little rim light. You may just be able to make out that there's a little bit of brightness just along that edge, and obviously it's more significant depending on the type of material. So that brings me to the next subject. We've got our basic light setup, but at the moment we've just got a simple diffuse. That isn't realistic for material. So another source of light in the scene is reflected light. I'm going to bring up the node editor because it's easier to see how things work. You can do it all over here, but I must say I find the node editor, once you get used to it, is much better for cycles material setup. And all of this is about cycles, by the way, although some of the theories holds true for Blender internal render as well. So I'm going to add a mix shader, and I'm also going to add a glossy shader, and I'm going to plug the glossy into the other side of the mix shader. So we've now got 50% glossy. They always come out slightly off-white for some reason, and 50% diffuse. So if I turn it all the way this way, it's completely diffuse, and all the way this way, it's completely glossy. You can see that the roughness isn't at zero at the moment, which is why we can still see this edge of the sphere, because there's some randomization of the bounce of the light. If I turn the glossiness down, you can just see a reflection of the distant light. If I wanted to get rid of that, I would turn off glossy down here for the light, but obviously I do want that, so I'm going to leave that there. And you can see there's light being reflected off the cube here onto this surface. And if we turn it up to completely rough, it's almost like a diffuse, but not quite. It obviously has, you can see it's slightly darker in here. So let's put this back to, say, 0.1, which is still a fairly shiny object. But obviously we can't see the surface at all at the moment. So typically when you use a glossy like this, unless it's a mirror, you will turn this down. And most metals you'll do this as well. I'm going to change the color of these objects as well to help show it up. Let's make them blue. All the way up here they go black because they're just reflecting light. And then as we turn it down, you can see the reflection's still there until you get to zero, but it's the strength of that reflection is much dimmer. So if I turn it to, say, a typical setting for a non-mirrored object, it's about 0.025. And now I can set the roughness to completely glossy and it looks like a really highly polished object there. Or I can set it up to a much higher value and obviously it looks much duller. Try 0.05, which means it's quite shiny. So the next thing is to see what else we can add to this. So how about making the object slightly transparent? In other words, translucent. I'm going to add another shape here. I'm going to duplicate my cube there, go into edit mode and delete that rear face as vertices. So that just leaves me a little plane. Rotate it on the Z a little, scale it up, bury it a little, and let's see what that looks like. I want it just sort of partially covering the other objects. So With that material selected, we're now going to add another shader, which is going to be a translucent shader. Now, if I just plug that straight in, that is essentially just translucent now. And we can turn the brightness right up. And although it's not that easy to tell, you can see here how the back, remembering that the key light is over here, is quite bright, and the front less so because we've got no diffuse on there to really reflect the light. So if we then add a new mix shader, and I'll talk about whether it's a mix shader that's the right thing or not in a moment, plug those into there and then take the output into there. Set this to say 50% at the moment, and currently the translucent is set to white. So if we look round behind, you can see that the light becomes white as it passes through. We've got a bit of blue light reflecting off these objects, but essentially it becomes white. I'm now going to add an RGB node, which just allows me to easily set the same color for multiple nodes as I want to. So I'm going to take that color into there and the same color into the translucent node. Let's move this one out the way. And now you can see straight away that the translucent light is also blue. If I turn this up to full, again, we've got no real diffuse light, we've only got translucent light. Now, there's a school of thought that says it should actually be an add shader. So if we go into here, we can see there's an add shader. And what that will do is it will take both inputs and add them together to give the output. So in doing that, you can see these are all much brighter now because they're adding both diffuse. I'll delete that one so it's out of the way for the moment. So it's adding both the diffuse and glossy and the translucent. And I'm going to swap these around now. So I'm going to take that output to there, move my glossy over here. I don't always do it this way around if I've got alpha textures and things like that. And then put that through there. So now the translucent light is being added to the diffuse light, and then that's being mixed with any glossy light that we've got. So we can see we've got some blue light shining through there and some reflected light, and they're about the same. So is that realistic? Probably not. So what I typically do is add a gamma node into the color for the translucent node. One means it doesn't do anything, a larger number means it darkens it. So I'll take that up to say 1.4, and you may just be able to see if I turn it up to a silly value, it actually darkens it quite a bit, but it is a gamma curve, so it isn't as simple as brightness. It's actually a curve that is applied, so it's sort of more intense color as well as darker color, which is more realistic. But normally I only do that at about 1.7, something like that. And there's a lot of light in the scene as well, which is possibly also making it more difficult to see. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch from these object light sources to a much simpler light source, which is a lamp. And I'm going to add a sun lamp. Sun lamps are quite special. Doesn't matter where they are in the scene, they really just define the direction that the sun is going to come from. Set that to rendered. It's much clearer now that we've got some translucence there. In fact, if I perhaps make a duplicate of that one, move it there, and perhaps set it up something like that, you can now see how there's a slight difference between this one and this one. It's only very slight. Obviously the light's coming through here. I can select my sun and I can put that up a little. Basically you lose some of the depth of the shadows, and you can even see some of the bounce light coming back through here. Typically use multiple important sample as well. That will just help with the quality of the scene. Except there are occasions when it doesn't, so you need to test it. So a little, before I do any more on this material, a little bit about the sun lamp. You see we've got a size here. If you're in an outside scene and it is simulating a sunny day, the size of the sun should be quite small. This isn't the real size of the sun, obviously. This is about how it affects the scene. So you can see it's fairly blurry at the moment. If I set this to 0.01, the shadows become much sharper. I'd even try 0, and you can see we've got completely crisp shadows now. It might be good for moonlight, perhaps. If it's a more overcast day, especially if it's light sources that are much closer, you need larger sizes. This is also true of object lights, but it's somewhat harder to control because size also affects the brightness of object lights, whereas it doesn't affect the brightness of lamps. So if I go to 1, you can see it's a very, very diffuse light, almost as if it's a completely overcast day. So somewhere between that, 0.1 is a good in between, that's the default, but indicates there's a bit of cloud perhaps in front of the sun. And then When you get down to 0.05, it's starting to clear, and typically I use something around 0.01 for a bright direct sunlight, and of course you'd have a slight colour to it as well. So that's a little bit about the sun. You can tell it to cast shadows or not cast shadows, but obviously for photorealism you want to cast shadows. So something else we need to look at is some slightly more complex effects in reflections. So in real world objects, typically light does not simply bounce in the same amount off a surface that is at various different angles. So an angle which is very shallow as the light comes in and bounces off, so if it were coming in here and bouncing off, that would be quite a shallow angle. That will actually tend to reflect more light, except for a few special materials, than light that comes in much more directly. So that would tend to be much more absorbed. And we can simulate that. So I'm going to select my sphere now, and I'm going to set this to a unique material. Call that T2. I'm going to set this to a fairly reddish color, and we're going to get rid of the translucent shader and just take that straight in to the mix shader. In fact, we're not going to use a diffuse at all. We're just going to use a glossy. You could just put the colour straight here, of course. And I'm going to turn the roughness up a bit for a minute while we look at it. And I don't need... I'm going to set my mix shader to 1 for the moment. So it's effectively, it's not there. So if I turn this roughness down now, you could say this is simulating polished gold. And it sort of is. You can see the reflections over there. If I set this to 0.015... that's very much like polished gold now, in that you can see these objects over here, you can see it's colouring the scene, and it's even colouring the light. But it isn't quite right. Unless you stare at real gold and compare it, you'd probably struggle to tell, but there are some differences. Obviously, there is a whole branch of computer graphics all obsessed with photorealism, and the degree to which you do this is both down to how much time you've got, and how much time you want to spend on any specific aspect of a scene while you work on the whole thing. Typically, I rough out a whole scene and then start to work on elements of it until I'm happy with it, and that may mean it hasn't reached a level of photorealism, because photorealism isn't always the goal. Sometimes it is, though. So what can we do to make the light bouncing off this object behave more like a real material? Well, we're going to take this mix shader out, I think, for now, and I'm going to add a layer weight node. We'll put that here. Facing is what determines whether the light has bounced off a face that is facing the viewer or one that is not facing the viewer. So if we plug that into roughness, what we can now do by adjusting this value is effectively increase the roughness along this edge. And it's a very sensitive setting. So you can see it's affecting it just there. And you can see how we're starting to get a little bit of rim light there now. If I take this away, you can see that's vanished. I bring it back, it comes back. But typically I tend to use this one for objects which aren't completely glossy. So the other option is to use the Fresnel output. And now you can see we've actually got around that rim there a little bright edge. So at naught, it's obviously doing nothing. If I do 0.01, just starting to get something come along there. And obviously we can take it up much higher. So it's a similar effect to facing. But there's a little bit more mass going on, I think, in this one. So you can use that to simulate more realism, but you can do more than this with it. So let's take that away from roughness, leave the roughness the same, and we'll just add in a mix node. This time, I'm not going to keep that color input. What I'm going to do is add a more red, slightly darker color down the bottom, and that feeds into there. But I'm going to control the mix with this. So I'm going to put that into there. I need now a slightly whiter background so that we can see what's going on. So let's turn the blend up, and you can see along that edge there, I'll give the sky a texture as well. And you can see as I turn this up, we get an effect where sort of a color comes in from the edges there. And if you want it to be more associated with the edges, we can use Fresnel. And you can see you get a similar effect. So the idea of this is obviously that while the reflections are the same, the colour the metal gives to the reflections differs as you go toward the edge. And it's up to you how you set that up. I could set this as a very strange colour, and obviously that's not photorealistic, but it gives you an interesting material. So here, for example, you can see where we've got the edge of the material, it's gone blue, but as it comes into the middle, it goes into the orangey colour again. I'll make the colour a bit stronger. And that's quite an interesting material. Arguably, it's not photorealistic, but it's quite an interesting effect. And then you can combine this with the glossy. I should say that with metals, by the way, metals are generally the only material, or one of the few materials, that have coloured reflections. Most other materials, such as plastic or wood, their glossy should be set to white. They just reflect light at whatever colour is incoming. If you set them to coloured, it starts to look a little strange. But you can have unusual materials as well, like this one, that don't simply do that. So a little bit about metals then. So I'll select my strange object. I've talked about some of the subtleties of metals, but now we'll just talk more generally. So here I have my glossy object. It's mostly reflective. There's a little bit of roughness on it. There is no colour on it at the moment. That's probably analogous to perhaps mercury or a very good mirror, but it isn't so good for simulating an actual real-world metal. So as a rough guide, if it's gold, select a fairly orangey red colour as your starting point, and then just decide what kind of gold is it. Is it very dark gold or light gold? As I said before, you need to play with other things as well. I'm going to make this a little less sharp in its shininess to set things up properly. For copper, it actually is quite a bit more red, but not too strong. So fresh copper would look like that. If once it's oxidised a bit, it starts to go more in this direction. Note that I've still got this up high. If I want the metal to look more oxidised, I can actually turn the brightness down, and I'll show you that again in a moment. For silver, start with a completely white point, then just take it ever so slightly yellow. Reason being that some of these metals, as soon as their clean surface is exposed to the air, they develop a very fine layer of oxide, which has a colour to it. And in the case of silver, that colour is a sort of greeny-yellow colour. And how strong you want that is up to you. Now, you can make the silver look more tarnished and older by just darkening it. So it's the same amount of colour, but it's darker. And if you want to simulate something like steel, make it ever so slightly blue. Just think blue steel. And again, you can darken it to make it look older. And then things like brass are somewhere in between that. So in terms of light, we've talked about reflected light, we've talked about translucent light. But we haven't talked yet about things like glass. So let's make something like a vase. So here's my vase or vase. I'll give it its own unique material. Rotate it a little bit just so that we can see edges. And I think I'm going to remove these other shapes because they're going to slow the preview rendering down. The machine's getting noisy enough as it is. So the obvious thing to do is to simply add a glass shader. So I'll remove all of this, add a glass shader, and connect that into the surface. Now, as a start of a 10, that's not bad. That's a pretty good attempt at simulating glass. But one thing you will notice if you just simply use the default settings is it looks a little smoky, a little dark. And that's because, once again, for whatever reason, the default for the colour of the glass is not completely white. Push that up. Now, straight away, we've got a slightly better looking glass. This does several things for us. It gives us a nice shiny surface, as well as a transparent material, as well as the refraction that glass gives you. So you can see the background here is being distorted, and we've got multiple reflections going on along these very thick edges. Now you notice we've got some fireflies or white dots appearing down here. And this is very common when you use the glass shader. It'll usually be even worse when you use objects as lamps. Now if you're not too worried about caustics, and I'll explain what they are in a minute, what you can do is turn off caustics here. So let's do that now, and you notice that's got rid of all those fireflies. If you're not worried about what's going on down here, that's fine. However, if you're using small pieces of glass, such as perhaps creating gems and things like that, if you turn off caustics, you'll often find that they just don't, they look very dark. So I've got a gemstone here. I'm going to make my vase a little smaller and put that over here. So there's my gemstone. And you can see it's working, but it's very dark down here. Once I turn caustics on, you can see we're starting to get light shining through it. And there's even light and dark spots. I can affect how those caustics work with index of reflection. And one of the great things with the internet is you can look up the index of reflection pretty much any transparent material. 1.4, 1.5 is about right for a glass. Obviously they do vary depending on the type of glass. Again, with photorealism, if you can, you want to be able to select the right index of reflection for the right material. Offhand, I don't know what diamond is, but we'll set that to, say, 1.65. That may be somewhere near. For water, it's about 1.33, and ice slightly different as well. So you can see now down here we're getting some caustics, as they're called. If I turn caustics off, it's just a dark shadow. So it's up to you, depending on how important the caustics are to your scene. But one word of warning, if your gem's mounted in something, or your piece of glass or whatever, you will tend to get just much darker gems if there are no caustics. You just have to understand that it's going to add more noise to your scene, so it may require a lot more rendering. You can help it by using filter glossy. So if we put 0.2 there, for example, it helps to smooth it out a little bit, but it's still fighting a difficult battle against the fireflies here. So it really is down to what you're trying to do. If it's an animation, you may want to consider whether that's something you want or not. An alternative method for glass, we move that away for a moment, is to make your own glass shader. So we can add a transparent shader, we can add a glossy shader, and we can add a refraction shader. So if we put the glossy there and a refraction there, and we add a mix shader, and I'll put my glossy into that mix shader, and then I'll add another mix shader and put those into there, and then I'll add a layer weight shader again and put that up here. Back to rendered. So at the moment we've got some roughness on the glossy, so we'll take that down to zero and make sure it's up at maximum. So they look like sort of transparent objects. We've even got a bit of light coming through. But what we really need to do is affect how much we show refraction based on the layer weight. So if we put Fresnel down into there, now you can see we're starting to get something a bit more like the glass shader that we had. And we can turn no caustics on, and we still get some of the effect. And obviously we can play with the layer weight to determine how much that shows up in our scene. So that's just point one there for now. And we can use facing instead if we want to. And obviously it's fading a bit too much there. So this may be a halfway house if you're really struggling with the noise, because you see we're getting some light through there. It's coming through. We're getting some degree of caustics, and I think our refractions are a little bit dark there. So we're getting some degree of caustics, but we aren't getting the noise that you get with the glass shader. I'm not going to suggest this is as good as the glass shader, but it can be a good halfway house. And then it's just how bright do you want the reflections? So that's a nice sort of halfway house, as I say, to give you something that approximates glass without the cost of the noise that you get with the glass shader. But it's not quite as realistic as the glass shader, of course. And I think I had this to something like 1.65. And you may want to add an actual diffuse surface as well. So going back to the simple glass shader, what if we've got coloured glass? So let's just apply a colour to that. So a sort of ruby glass or ruby, perhaps not too dark. Glass textures and transparent materials only require a very small amount of colour to show up quite strongly. So we've talked about reflected light, translucent light, transparent light. We've talked about the effects of the angle that the light hits things from. All of these things pretty much apply to almost every material to some degree. So if you really want a realistic material, it should always have a diffuse, pretty much, with the possible exception of clear things like water, but it should certainly always have a glossy and very often a surface. So let's just quickly talk about surfaces. So here is a basic cube with a simple white material on it. Let's change that material to a somewhat green colour, and we'll go back to GPU rendering now, so it's a bit quicker. As I said before, we need to add a mix shader and we need to add a glossy. So most of your materials should start life somewhat like this. Unless it's a really reflective object, then this would be set relatively low. Make sure that's at full white. Decide on the roughness. So that's actually quite a glossy object, but the intensity of the reflections is quite low. If I turn it up, you can now see that it's reflecting everything, but we'll go for 0.05. I think we'll darken that a bit just to make the reflections a little easier to see. So I mentioned surface textures. So there's a couple of ways to do these. Very easy one is to add a noise texture. So you see, I haven't unwrapped this yet. I've made a noise texture and I'm gonna take the output. It can be color or factor, doesn't matter, and put that into displacement. And you can see already, we've got a sort of waviness on the surface. And you can see here how the glossiness is actually picking up where the faces are appropriate. It's picking up some light from the floor here. And then we can turn the scale up to say 50 or even 250. So that's a very high scale, very, very small grain as it were. but the height of it is probably a bit too much. We'll come back, I think, a little bit just to make it a bit easier to see. And what I would also do is typically add a math node in there, set to multiply, and then just turn that down. When it's at zero, obviously there is no surface texture, and at one we just get a very subtle texture. So that's just a very simple grain effect. What we can also do is that we can add color ramp, drop that in there, which then allows us to select parts of the noise texture to affect our surface and parts not to. So you can see now we're getting a slightly different texture, almost like it's been smudged. And I'll turn the size of that noise back down to 50 just to make it a bit easier to see. So it's not really affected the geometry, so it doesn't seriously impact the render time, but it makes it look as though it has. And it's a very good idea to have some degree of surface finish, whether you do that by using an image overlaid onto it. So that would just be, instead of the noise texture, I would add an image texture, and perhaps it might be some asphalt texture here, and plug that in there. But bear in mind, I haven't UV unwrapped this, so I'm going to look from above in edit mode, go into edit mode, U, project from view bounds. That's only going to really work on the top here because of the way I did it. So back into rendered view, and that's giving me a nice random texture, and I can again select from that texture the colors that I want to affect my surface. But again, this is a simulated surface. This isn't actually affecting the geometry, so it doesn't seriously affect the render time. And in addition, another thing worth doing, whether you're using a noise texture or an image texture, is to affect the strength of the glossy. So I can take the color and I can plug that into the factor there. Now initially that's a bit too much because that's going between completely shiny and not shiny at all. So what I'll also normally do is add another math node in there. And in fact I'd probably take it from the output of my color ramp rather than where I got it there. So we can now see there are little bits that are more reflective and bits that aren't. And if I want to, I can turn that up the other way. So most of it's reflective now, but it looks like it's got some little patches that have obviously been eaten away and are no longer as shiny as the rest of it. And I can vary how extreme that influence on reflection is with this little multiplier here. And that should be a common sort of setup. So to recap, we've talked about the effects of caustics, as demonstrated in this image. We've talked about the color of metals and how glossy works, and how we should almost always use it. We haven't talked about particles and noise yet, so very briefly, if you want some random dirt on a surface and it's a close-up image, you really need to create a particle system. I'm not going to go into the details of a particle system here because this is really just about how to do it. Create a load of random shapes by any of the various methods that I've shown before, and then distribute a particle system around. And what you can also do, if we subdivided this surface multiple times, is then define areas where the particles are denser and where they aren't. Or if you don't want to do it by simply selecting vertices, go to weight paint mode and we just do something like that, so that there's some areas where the particles are quite dense. Every time you click again they become more dense. And there's other areas, such as around here, where they're not dense. Add a particle system, tell it to use, in this case, an object, but you probably create a group of objects. We'll say a cube, 1, 1, turn off physics, come down to vertex group, and just select group, which is the one we created with the density. Obviously a randomness on the size. We can also add random phase and random rotation, and there we go. And all I've used there is cubes, and obviously if they were further from the camera that would be perfectly adequate. And you can then determine how you use that. You can say completely random distribution or not, as you see fit. So that looks quite good for a little pile of dust, dirt, sand, whatever. A little bit about depth of field. Depth of field can make your scene look like it's a miniature or a very large scene. So I've brought my other objects back. I'm going to put them back here. I'm going to select my camera, go into rendered mode, and come down to the bottom where it says depth of field. Typically I will add an empty so that I can move things around. An empty is an object that doesn't show up, or I will just use one of the objects in the scene. So if we assume that the sphere there is the focus of interest for the scene, just make it a different color so it's more obvious. If we look over here at aperture, if it's set to zero, that means you've got an infinite focus. Everything's always in focus. As you start to turn this up, anything that is in front of or behind the focal point starts to go out of focus. And the larger this number, the more out of focus it is. So if I demonstrate, there is a very subtle depth of field here. So this is out of focus. This is probably out of focus, but not by so much, because it's about the same level as this. And you can see by looking at these particles, they're relatively out of focus here, and they come into focus here and probably soften a little bit as they go further back. We shrink that sphere down and put it somewhere like this, so it's right in mid part of the distance. And now we render. So the sphere is completely in focus. You can see the particles around here are in focus. These are out of focus. This is slightly out of focus. And then they go out again back here. And as I turn this radius up, that effect becomes more and more extreme. So I'm going to set it to 0.1. So now we can really see everything up here is really blurred. Even this blue square is blurred. Everything back here is blurred. The particles towards the back are blurred. And only the particles pretty much underneath or level with the sphere are in focus. And obviously we can go even higher than that. And that reaches a point, now looks just insane, but if I set it to say 0.6, what it looks like to me is that this is a microscope. And we're looking at something that's extremely small, and it's only this object which is in the right focal plane. So if you want to simulate, if I set this to something a bit more reasonable, say 0.1, so that even 0.1 is still quite a large amount of depth of field. If you want to simulate something that's miniature, use a larger number here. Real cameras have a depth of field, of course, unless it's a very bright day, but overuse of depth of field really can make a scene look wrong. But if you want to simulate something that's small, so to me now this looks like it's a fairly small, perhaps a centimeter or two scene, and I'm using a macro camera to take a photograph. If I set this to 0.01, now we've got a very subtle depth of field on there, and the feeling of the scene when you look at it is that it's somewhat larger. And of course, very often you can have things like a tree's branch very close to the camera. And especially if you haven't got that much detail in the branch, it's good to add some depth of field on it. And that's fine. That looks okay. But if it's overdone, it really does go too far. So another effect that people often overuse is chromatic aberration. This is where the curvature of a lens causes light to refract to different degrees depending on the wavelength of the light. So in other words, the color of the light. So back into the node editor. What I'm going to do is render this scene. So we just set this to 25 samples and just render that. Now, real lenses do exhibit chromatic aberration, but I think if you look even on a relatively cheap camera, you will be hard pressed to see that very often, unless it is a macro photograph where you're pushing the lens quality to its limits. So again, don't overuse this effect unless you are using it for aesthetic or artistic reasons. So I'm going to go to the compositing nodes, and here's our render layer output, and here's our composite. I'm going to go to the distort options and select lens distortion, and we'll put that into there. Initially, because it's set to zero, we've got nothing. If I start to put a setting on dispersion, you can see the shape of the image altered slightly there. And I'm going to put this up to 0.5, and you should be able to see now we're getting that sort of strange sort of lensing effect around the edges of things where there are changes in color and things like that. So we've got this yellow showing up here fading off to green, and the whole thing is being distorted. Now I think most people don't use quite this much of it, but I wanted to put a lot on so that you knew what you were looking for. So I'll set this now down to 0.1. It's making my eyes water a little bit seeing that. So that's 0.1. That's somewhere nearer what a lot of people use, maybe 0.05. But even that, although relatively subtle and tends to affect the edges, which is where a real lens would affect it, to me that's a camera of 30, 40 years ago. That's really bad. It just looks like a cheap camera. Now, if what you're trying to do is simulate a very cheap camera lens, then perhaps that's the right thing to do, or a microscope. But to me, it doesn't add to the realism of the scene. But that's just my view. If you think it makes the scene look more realistic, have fun with it. And that's how you do it. You do it with lens distortion. So if I turn that up to really high degree, and it takes a second to composite it, some of the other settings are things like fit, jitter, and projector. So projector is more like it's the lens of the projector that has the chromatic aberration rather than the camera. So it tends to work somewhat differently. You can see we've got some edges here. It's not distorting in the same way. So if I take that off again, I think what fit does is it literally brings the image back in after expanding some parts of it. It's basically distorting the image but distorting it differently depending on the colour. So that's chromatic aberration. You can use that if you need to, but if you do, I strongly suggest keep it very subtle. And in the same node, we've got distort, as you can see. That's very much your sort of the fisheye effect of a lens. But there are other ways to achieve that as well. I haven't used that very much. So we've talked about the caustic side of things. We've talked about metals and reflections. We've talked about particles and absorption. We've talked about translucence, which is what I'm using in this scene. We've covered surface textures to help to add realism, whether they be dirty textures or textures simulating a textured surface, such as on this table and on this computer. We've talked about depth of field, so you can see here I've got the leaves that are quite close, fairly out of focus, perhaps a bit too much, and then coming into focus around the middle there and perhaps starting to go out again at the back. You can see also on the pumpkins that I've used a random texture to add a texture to that surface on the displacement. I haven't covered how to create something like this pearl texture. Again, one that you're probably only going to use relatively rarely, but if I had, I think I combined actually a velvet shader with a glossy, but let's try the anisotropic shader and just feed that straight into the surface. Go to rendered, and you can see we're getting something. And we can set rotation here, and that gets you some interesting effects and the degree of anisotropy. What I think I did was I used a velvet texture coupled with our favorite glossy shader. And now you can play with the sigma of the velvet until you get what you're looking for. And I think pearls tend to be ever so slightly yellow, probably depends on the pearl. And you can play with that to get different effects there. Obviously this is relatively shiny pearl. I'm going to turn the strength of that reflection down, and so on. It's exactly what you want to do, is up to you. Again, you could even mix that just to soften the effect with a diffuse shader, perhaps even give it a slightly different color. And that way you can shade between the two. I think I like it like that. So roughly speaking, that's a pearl texture. And obviously I would add a surface texture as well, and perhaps add some swirly color changes in there with a distorted random. So one last note about surface textures. I've added the surface texture of this box. I've just hidden everything except for the box. I think I'll keep these as well. So I added a surface texture on this box by using material effects, displacement. Sometimes you don't want to do it that way. Sometimes you want real geometry. Now, only do it this way if you have to, because it's an extreme amount or whatever. So there is, you can see the texture on there now, it's just showing that because I'm showing materials. What I'm gonna do is add, I think just on that top face, a lot more vertices. And I think we'll even go more than that. But before I do that, I'm gonna get rid of this particle system, because that's causing problems, because obviously it was duplicating this box. So W, subdivide again. So I divided that by 50 and then just subdivided it once more. So just on this face, we've now got an awful lot of vertices, which is slowing Blender down a little bit. But I'm now going to add a modifier called the Displace modifier. I very crudely unwrapped this side. I'm going to look from above, press U, and say Project from View. And I'm going to select Project from View Bounds. Now I'm going to select New under Texture. We'll select UV Coordinates, now that we've unwrapped it. And we'll now select the control there, which takes us to material view. Click in here and I'll just choose the asphalt texture that I already had selected. And if we come out of edit, you can see we've already got now quite a large displacement on that surface. It's actually trying to displace the rest of it as well, so I need to limit the effect in this case. So I'll come out with those vertices selected, I'll come over to the object data tab and click plus to add a vertex group and assign that, then come back to the displace modifier and select the group that I just created. Now I'll come out of edit mode, and at least in theory it's not affecting the rest of the vertices. There aren't very many vertices on this cube, so it may be doing it, maybe just bleeding through anyway. I'm just going to add a bit of a subdivision to the rest of it just to clean it up a bit. So I've just added a few more vertices so that it knows where it can displace and where it doesn't need to. So if I now reduce this displacement modifier, that's 0.1, we'll go for 0.025. And you can now see this is without using a proper bump map, but we've got something that's not bad. It's using basically the bright spots to determine where the object should be high and where it should be low. So the benefit of this is you can really create some quite strong displacements, and you can control the size of those displacements. The downside is you need a lot of vertices to do it. If we look at the rendered view and we select smooth shading, you can see we've actually got some geometry showing up there. I've used this in the past for creating 3D prints that need some texture on the surface, but for rendering, it's quite a high cost method for giving a surface texture. You're much better off using bump maps or displacements, and displacements are very easy to do. So the final thing I wanted to demonstrate to something that can add realism to a scene are dirty vertex colors. So I'm going to create an object and we'll make it some kind of vase. I won't worry too much about giving it a lot of thickness right now. What I am doing is giving it some variations in its surface. But we'd certainly put a subdivision surface on there and set it to smooth shading. So there's our simple vase shape. I'm going to apply this subdivision surface. So we've got a lot of vertices there now. And I'm going to go to materials and add a basic material. So if we look at that rendered, we can see there it is, very plain vase. And what I'll do is I'll do a small render of that just so that we can refer back to it. So there it is. And now I'm going to change the object mode to vertex paint, come over to paint and say dirty vertex colors. Notice immediately it got darker, and where there are ridges and overhangs, it is also darkened. And I can actually do that again to make it more extreme. So we've got a fairly extreme, what are called dirty vertex colors now. And if I come over to the properties menu, you can see we've got a vertex color setting in here now. The default is it's called Col. You can change that name by double clicking. If I now pull down this color, at the moment, I go back to object mode, this is still here. If I just look in rendered view, that doesn't look any different. But what I can do is use these attributes. So I need to add color mix node. First of all, we'll set one side to the same white as we originally had, and the other side we'll set quite a dark brown color. So at that, it's either dark brown or it's white, depending on this factor input. Now I can add an input, which is an attribute, and I give it the same name as this. So it's, at the moment, it's called col. Take the factor output and put it into the factor of that mix node. You may also find you need to increase the degree of variation with the multiply node, as you can see there. So now we're starting to get a variation that's quite extreme at the moment, and very often you will find it sort of up the wrong way. So we can then vary what the color is with our dirty vertex colors. So you can see here I'm going quite extreme now, and of course we can put a second math node in with just an add node, and one would obviously be too much there. I've chosen a much more visible color there, but in reality you might just have another white color but just slightly darker for a white vase. And in addition to that, of course, we can add a mix shader, a glossy shader. We'll set the roughness down pretty low, connect that in, and then we can use the output of our dirty vertex colors to control the mix of glossy. And obviously we can have our own multiply node on there. So with no dirty vertices coming through, it's basically not glossy at all, and then we can start to show glossy, or of course multiply it by a negative number but add in an add math node. And what this will do then is the dirty vertices obviously become less shiny depending on what you want to achieve. If we render that, we've got some areas that are shiny and some are not. We've got darker areas and lighter areas, and if we now compare that with the original object, which is obviously not shiny at all anyway, you can see this is very flat. It's very hard to see that detail, but adding the dirty vertex colors really highlights, even if you look here where there isn't much in the way of reflection, really helps to highlight the shape and texture. So that can really add, and of course what it does is it tends to put this darkening attribute into areas that would naturally collect grime and so on, and therefore gives a little bit more realism. So I hope you found that tutorial useful. If you did, let me know. The competition that I ran is now ended, and I'm just looking at deciding who the winner's going to be, and I'll hopefully announce that in a video this week. Hope to see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.